So, like we always do, we start with the four major numbers. These are my current numbers up to date, 2021, what I'm currently working with. So, income is averaging roughly $25,000 a month. Okay, this is gross before taxes. Okay, net. I shouldn't say net. Gross before taxes, $25,000 per month. Expenses. This is everything. $10,000 a month on average. Could be a little more, a little less, depends. Debt, I got zero debt. I've got leveraged debt and I have access to capital. What is leveraged debt? I've got a 0% credit card with like roughly $10,000 on it at 0%. It cost me $0 to put $10,000 on there. I got rewards, cash back, points, and it's 0% for the next 12 months. That's leveraged debt, zero cost of borrowing. And I use that money to make an investment to earn over a 10% rate of return. Boom. I have a lease. I have a car lease. The contract is for 3 years and I pay $354 a month, I believe, or $351. So do $354 times 36 payments. That's $12,744 that I'm gonna pay to that lease. That can sometimes be considered a debt, but in my case, because I have great credit score, right, I got good history, I was able to obtain a lease payment of a little over 1.5% of the MSRP of the vehicle, right, which is not bad at all. The goal, shout out to Nam, who has a YouTube channel where I got this information from. He talks about how to get a car lease for 1% of the MSRP of the vehicle. And to me, that's brilliant, because if I'm paying $12,744 and the MSRP of the vehicle that I got was just under 30 grand. So instead of me spending $30,000 or buying a vehicle, which is it's a Hyundai Tucson 2022, I think, or 2021, I forget. And so it's one of the newest models for Hyundai, for the SUV, the Tucson. And that's what it costs to purchase it right off the lot, MSRP, right? Instead of me deploying over 30 grand to that vehicle, I could get it for $12,000, almost $13,000. What's that, like a third, right? I don't even know what the percentage is on that, but it's a lot less than 30 grand, right? So I'm leveraging debt through a lease. I agree to pay 354. And what's beautiful is when you got good credit, you get access to deals. You get access to different things that normally wouldn't be offered. For example, with this vehicle, I get 3 years during the whole time of me driving that lease, that vehicle, which is not mine, right? Belongs to the dealer, but I'm temporarily basically renting it for 3 years, and that's what it's going to cost me. So I'm driving this vehicle, and for 3 years, I don't have to pay for maintenance, oil change, tire rotation, all those little other expenses that come with it. So that came with the package. In addition to that, no money down, right? I didn't have to put any money down whatsoever to get that low payment because I had good credit. So you can see how much money I save, and then the opportunity cost, the difference, which is what, $18,000, $17,000 or so, that doesn't go to that vehicle, can now go to investments, funding my business, increasing my income. So when I say I'm debt-free from paying interest, and I'm debt leveraged. That's what I mean by being debt leveraged. I leverage credit cards, credit lines, leasing vehicles. I do two leases, by the way. You know, I have a lease for my mom's car, my car. I pay for both. Same thing, no money down on her vehicle as well. It's a GMC Terrain, right? No money down, just pay a payment. And that's a $40,000 vehicle, I believe. And the payment on that was 380 or 371. Not bad at all. You know, or it might be 40 grand, might be like 36 or something. I know GMC's, it's definitely a little more expensive than the Hyundai's. Nonetheless, that's what I mean by being debt-free and debt leveraged. Final number, cash flow. Anywhere between 10, 15,000 per month. Could be higher, could be lower. Depends on what comes in. All right. Now, on the infinite banking side of things, just so you can see the numbers, up-to-date numbers, what's going on, I've got two cash value life insurance policies. These are whole life insurance policies, one with Guardian, one with MassMutual. Guardian funding 70 grand a year. I'm in my third year. So I've paid in principal dollars, 210K in principal dollars. Cash value to date, $201,580.64. I've got $79,446.83 in loans. MassMutual, $15,000 a year. In my second year, technically this is a three-year policy because I was originally funding a MassMutual policy at $6,000 a year. And then within that, literally like a year after putting in $6,000, I then converted it to increase the amount to 15 grand. So I did a 1035 exchange, is what that's called. And so I've been paying 15K for 2 years, $6,000 for 1 year, total cash value to date, $33,267. Loans, $13,500. That's the interest rate on the loan, 5% simple interest, 6% simple interest on the Guardian. Now this is 2021. Starting in 2022, the loan interest rates are going to be coming down. I don't know by how much just yet, but they are coming down. And if you go to IBC Global, check out their channel, they've got a ton of content on what that rate is gonna be. I don't know it off the top of my head, but I do know it's coming down. In addition to that, the other thing that's coming down is the guarantees on the life insurance policy. And we can get into that on another video. I'll have content. Like I said, IBC Global's already ahead of this. They got plenty of content that goes over the guaranteed rate changes, the neck law changes, the loan interest rate changes. As of right now with Guardian, when I borrow, I'm charged 5.66% and some change. If I pay the loan interest upfront in advance, I get charged 5.66%. If I let the loan interest ride out throughout the whole year, it'll be 6% simple interest, okay? Guardian's a little funky with how they do their accrediting rate versus loan interest rate. It can be a little confusing compared to a non-direct recognition company, which is pretty simple, straightforward. You get charged a set rate, you get credited the same or higher set rate. So with MassMutual, their crediting rate, 6%, right? Guaranteed, non-guaranteed. When you borrow against the cash value, 5% is your loan interest rate. So what ends up happening, you create a wash effect depending on how much you borrow, right? And also depending on how early you borrow. Typically in the early years, your policy is running a negative anyways. So you really can't say that you're running a wash. And this is part of me improving my language. In the past, I talk about creating a wash because of what I did outside of the policy is what created the wash. But if you just borrowed and did nothing with the money and you squandered it or you wasted it, you didn't really create a wash. It's gonna take some time for it to become a wash over time. As long as you continue to max fund it, then yes, you create a wash. But if you just did it 1 year and you're not producing anything and then you stop funding the policy, then we get into a little issue there. With Guardian, when I borrow against the cash value, they're gonna credit me a higher rate of 6% gross on the loaned dollars, and then the money that I didn't borrow keeps growing at the standard dividend rate that the company projects, which is 5.65%. So it gets a little funky, hard to calculate. Essentially, it still creates a wash at the end of the day, and then depending on what we do with the money can also enhance that arbitrage, all right? But again, in the beginning years, you're still running a negative internally in the policy, which is why you need to make sure you do a very good job when you do borrow against the cash value outside of the policy. So sometimes people will typically like to do pay off debt, high interest debt, 18%, 26%, 15, 12%. That creates a nice wash in the policy itself. And you're killing two birds with one stone. You're establishing the asset while simultaneously paying off debt. Not bad. Some people will make investments, do real estate. So now you have two assets with the same dollars growing in two different locations. You're paying the interest, you're financing the deal. You're becoming a bank to yourself. You still have to understand you're running a negative in the beginning, typically. Over time, you run a great positive. You end up being ahead of individuals that choose not to do it and just invest, right? Which both ways, you're gonna get results. You're gonna become successful if you do the right things, right? And you're ethical and you take care of your money and you steward it. You're gonna do good things. You're gonna have success. The difference is people that are doing infinite banking are also creating that insurance protection, and they could be potentially giving themselves access to more capital than the individual that chose not to do this. Because at the end of the day, when you're doing infinite banking, ideally, we're using savings dollars, emergency funds, sinking funds. We're using money that we're typically not gonna deploy or did not intend to deploy, versus investing dollars. That's different money that you allocate. So depending on what your cash flow is per month, you separate, you say this percentage goes to saving, this percentage goes to tithings and offerings, this percentage goes to investing, this percentage goes to taxes and inflation. And so what happens with IBC, with taxes and inflation, and then those savings dollars, you could have that sit in this type of high cash value life insurance account and have it grow throughout the year instead of it sitting, doing nothing in account, earning nothing. That's the only difference. That's the only head start advantage that we have over everyone else, right? So just being fully transparent there. So now that you've seen the two companies, the four major numbers, gave you all the insight, here are the two network marketing companies that I'm involved with. One is called LegalShield. The other one's called United Financial Freedom. Both have unique product and services. LegalShield provides legal identity, theft protection, legal protection at a certain standard for a certain cost. And there's a whole breakdown of the many different products and services, a lot of different price ranges. Very unique product. Then United Financial Freedom provides a software on how to mathematically, the fastest way mathematically to pay off all your debt is what they claim, right? Now, me as your personal finance geek of the 21st century, there was one point where, and still to this day, I still feel it, where this isn't to be cocky, but I know personally I can beat the software because of the strategies and the way that I calculate numbers and the way that I chunk. This isn't to be cocky, but the reality is some people are just not tech savvy. I'm one of those people. So the amount of time that it would take me to become tech savvy with the software, input the numbers, hold myself accountable, lock all the numbers in, really understand it, and to follow it and not be disobedient to it, because I'm the type that even when I see the software, I'm gonna have a little disobedience to it, because I'm like, oh, I want it to do this, I need it to do that, I want it to do this, I need it to do that. The reason why I partnered with the company is I believe eventually, with the advancement of technology, AI, software, advancements just in the marketplace overall, eventually this will outperform the finance geek. It will. So I know long term that there's going to be people that will always love the chalkboard, the whiteboard, pen and paper. There's no converting them. And I'm in that camp. You're just not going to convert me. For as long as I've been in business, only 3 years, not a long time, I've now generated over $1 million in revenue plus investments. And I still have not yet once used an Excel spreadsheet. It doesn't work for me. Now, that might change when I start making 5 mil, 10 mil, 25 mil, 30 mil, 50 mil. I may have to actually hire some people to produce financial statements for me, profit and loss, and do my own numbers for me because of the headache I would get trying to calculate all those numbers. I know that in the long term. As of today, I'm still very good at just writing the numbers out. I know the formulas that the softwares are trying to use. I just learned them it takes time, without a doubt, to do all this. Like, to write all this out, this takes me 45 minutes, 40 minutes to really think and write this out before I go live with you, right? And discuss it. Most people don't want to do that in today's environment. So there's a camp of people, and it's typically you watching, that are pen and paper, whiteboard, chalkboard. You're never going to convert. I get that. I love you. I'm with you. I'm going to stick with you on that all the way through. Now, the likelihood of you or I getting to 10 mil, 20 mil, 50 mil, 100 mil and up, very, 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 very small percentage. When that occurs, if and when that occurs, we need to eventually surrender to the tech, the AI, the softwares that are going to outperform us anyways in order to remain competitive in the marketplace. That's the way I look at it. Very, very simple. There's no beating it, right? People are putting their brains, their formulas, everything that I'm doing here, they're putting it into software and tech, and it's advancing. And the amazing part is, as that product eventually increases and gets better and improves, the client, the prospect, has the option. Either A, I do it alone, do it by myself, right? And become debt free and create, you know, financial independence, financial freedom. Route number two, I hire an expert, financial coach, financial advisor, financial consultant, a business coach, and I work with them one-to-one. The pro to that is you have accountability, you have support, you have an expert that's going to feed into your life. The con is that that person that you hired also is working with 500, 300, 250 other people. So you're not going to have access to them every single day. More like maybe once a month, maybe twice a month, maybe once a quarter, depending on what their rates are. That's the option that most of you and my clients are in right now, right? I talk to my clients either once a month, once every other month is typically the route that we go. Option three is software, AI, tech, where you get the best of all worlds. You can be alone. You don't have to hire the expert. The expert is in the software. Comes with customer support, training, tutorials, videos, self-paced, and you don't have to think anymore, which could be a pro and a con to an extent. But when you're in loads and loads of debt and you see a product such as this, and let's say you got 10, 15, 25 different mortgages and you're trying to figure out which one to tackle, and then you, instead of hiring an assistant that you're going to pay thousands of dollars or an expert to figure it out, you buy the software and you put all the numbers in. It says mortgage number 17, mortgage number 3, mortgage number 9, in that order, in 4.5 seconds. It'll tell you what to do. Bam, it runs the numbers. You'll be debt-free at this time frame. That's very valuable for my higher income earners that watch this channel, that are making six figures, multiple six figures, seven figures, and up. And even for my lower, higher five figures, could be very valuable. So that is what I am seeing with that particular company, which is why when I'm doing infinite banking for myself, the concept is already a long-term play, a long-term strategy. So when I'm borrowing against my cash value, I'm thinking of long-term plays that I can get involved with to eventually create that arbitrage wash of me paying interest back to the insurance company when I borrow against the cash value, but also that same money is going to be growing, eventually catching up to the loan interest, and then the profits that I produce with the cash value outside of the policy with tax-free dollars, right? And then those profits get taxed, the net goes back into the policy, rinse and repeat. So I'm always thinking of long-term play. So this case study is a 20 to 40 year long-term play. The reason why I chose the network marketing industry, number one, is because of my history, and number two, timing, the environment that we're in right now. The reality is that you have a extremely large population of people in America that chose to leave their job. They got fired, they got laid off, many different situations. They're being mandated to take a vaccine, and let's say they don't want to. So they leave their job either voluntarily or they get fired for their views, their beliefs, or whatever it is. A lot of that's going on in the country right now, which is now you've got this whole group of unemployed people. What do? They got to go somewhere. They got to make money somewhere. Some pivot, get a job somewhere else, higher rate, higher pay. Okay, cool. The other majority, start businesses. Okay, great. A big group of people are joining network marketing companies right now. It's insane. The amount of enrollment from the start of the pandemic up until now, I'm pretty sure a lot of top network marketing companies, MLM, direct sales companies are killing it right now with profits, revenue, products. It's insane. They're doing great. So when I look at that, I'm like, looks like I need to, you know, get ahead of this and then see the rewards 20 years from now, 10 years from now, 30 years from now, 40 years from now. I'm 25. 20 years from now, I'll only be 50. So that's the way I look at it. And so when I'm working with my clients, depending on your age, we're either doing long-term plays, depending on your age, with IBC, or it's a short-term play. If it's a short-term play, you have to be willing to amp up your activity. That's the only difference between a long-term play and a short-term play. And if it's a short-term play, your activity has to be amped up versus in a long-term play, you don't necessarily have to put in a lot of work in the beginning, but you put in a percentage of work consistently throughout that time frame, and you see the chart do that and it takes off. So with that being said, gave you the whole outline. The case study that we're gonna use out of the two companies, I'm gonna be using Legal Shield as my case study. And just to give you a little background information, when I graduated high school in 2014 and I got my first job, prior to that, flipping pizzas and prepping food at a little Italian restaurant, and a dishwasher, prepping food and stuff like that. Roughly about a year between 2014, 2015, a little bit of 2016, I got introduced to the network marketing industry. The first one was a direct sales company called Cutco, where I was selling knives, right? Then it was affiliate marketing or distributor marketing with Invicta Watches. I signed up to be a distributor, bought a couple of watches, sold the watches. So that's distributor type of affiliate marketing, direct sales, network marketing. The first company I got introduced was ACN. Then after that, it was Nerium. Then it was It Works. Then it was Herbalife. Then it was Isagenics. Then it was The Secret. Then it was Jeunesse. I mean, it was a ton. I got introduced to many different ones, joined a bunch of different ones, literally failed at all of them because I ended up quitting. Not because I wasn't necessarily making money. I sold product, made a little money, but eventually quit because it just wasn't in alignment with my purpose and values. It didn't get me closer to helping moms achieve financial freedom, create, restore their kingdom in their household. So it didn't align with that message. And then I didn't even know what my purpose was, right? So then I came across Legal Shield around 2016, I believe 2017. I never joined the business, but I became a client. Reason why I became a client was because my father experienced injustice, okay? He was wrongly accused of a bank robbery, okay? This was all over the news in New York at that time. Served 10 to 11 years or more, I think, in prison and was proven innocent. So he lost 11 years of his life, roughly. He lost the ability to raise a son. We're living in the greatest country in the world, and even that occurred. There's many stories. You see the movies. You've seen the movies. The Hurricane by Denzel Washington. The more recent one with Michael B. Jordan and Jamie Foxx. I mean, you hear the stories, right? Over and over and over again of people being wrongly convicted, innocent crimes. They didn't do the crime, but they did the time, right? And so the way their mission, their company, their values, it struck a chord at that time. I said, all right. Well, my father went through that. And, you know, we're living in a time now where there's a lot of division. We're not unified, really, as a country. Got a lot of different cultures. Got a lot of different histories, a lot of stains with different cultures. A lot of problems going on, a lot of chaotic events. So I say, you know, fast forward to now, this was in 2017, 2016, I was thinking, oh, this could be a, you know, this could be a really good product for myself to protect myself in the event I'm in a bind, I'm in a situation. I get pulled over by the police and God forbid, I get the wrong cop on the wrong day. That could happen. Now, thankfully, never had an issue with police officers. They've treated me with respect the whole time. I got pulled over. Every time I got pulled over, it's because I did something wrong. I sped, went past a stop sign, took a red light, was speeding on the highway, and more than 50% of the time, I walked away without a ticket. Very respectful police officers. So from my experience, I've had nothing but good experiences with police officers in terms of my interaction. Regardless of my circumstance, skin color, whatever it is, haven't had any issues. Now, could it happen? Sure, right? Could I be rolling in a state that is, you know, leaning one way, leaning this way, and, you know, I run through a speeding on the highway on 75, 95, whatever it is. If I'm in a situation, I get a bad cop or a cop on a bad day, I could tap into that Legal Shield product, call an attorney right off the bat, say, hey, Mr. Attorney, Mrs. Attorney, listen, I just got pulled over. I'm being pulled over right now. I'm pulling over slowly. I don't feel comfortable. It's a little dark in this area, but I don't know what to do because the next exit is not for another 3 miles. So I don't want to give the impression that I'm trying to run away, but I also don't want to be on a highway at, you know, 12 o'clock at night where it's just me and the cop. It's his word against mine. So what do I do? Dot, dot, dot. Now you have an attorney. At least if you did pull over 12 o'clock at night on the highway, you got an attorney on the phone that can speak on your behalf. God forbid that were to happen. More chords are being struck. I'm like, this is a great product. This is a great service. God forbid, if anything, if I get sued, you know, someone comes after me on my YouTube channel, you know, that's the best way to probably silence me or censor me. You know, we're living in a time of censorship, right? Where any little freaking thing you say offends, you know, two people, and then you're now canceled. You got cancel culture, you've got censorship, you got big tech companies running like governments, basically. They're like virtual governments. And so you've got all these different parameters as a young entrepreneur. Again, keeping an eye on this. This was my mindset thinking back in 2016, 2017. So I was a customer of the product for about 3 to 4 years. And then in 2019 is when I actually registered to enroll and become an associate agent in the business, which gives me the ability to sell the product to other people, right? So, been a customer for a while, joined the business in 2019. We're now in 2021. I'm gonna share with you revenues that I've made so far, total investment numbers, and then again, I'll look at your questions and we'll dive into it. So, Legal Shield case study, 20 to 40 year play. Here's the strategy. I'm borrowing against my high cash value life insurance policy. It's more than likely gonna be the MassMutual one. I'm considering either option one. I do what's called a cash value collateral loan, where I go to a bank and I'm able to get a lower rate than the interest rate from the insurance company. Anywhere maybe 3 or 4%. I went with the higher number, 4%. Lower interest rate from the bank. That cash value collateral loan is gonna be used for business. So the BCA stands for business checking account. So it goes into the business checking account, which then gets used for business purposes. It'll fund the network marketing business, which will produce profit. The goal is to produce 25% or more in profit year after year, each year. That's the goal. It's the standard that I'm setting. Now, with the cash value collateral loan, I'm paying 4% back to the bank, but that 4% through a tax strategy, running it through a business, could potentially be a write-off, which means that the money in the cash value never gets interrupted or touched. That money continues to grow. I sacrifice a little bit of freedom with the policy itself. It is a little, there's some added restrictions. You know, you're basically saying that, hey, if I don't pay this, then the bank can take from my cash value. And I think there's a percentage of how much I can actually get from the bank. I think you have to have X amount of dollars in the cash value policy built up before they even give you this. So that is one option. Second option is I just borrow against the policy, goes into personal checking account. I then move that money to the business checking account. I then fund the network marketing business that I want to get myself involved in. I create a budget. I go over what the startup cost is. I look at the compensation plan. I look at the cost to run that network marketing business. the big benefit typically is with network marketing is the startup costs are very, very low, typically, right? Not that much. And then the final results produce 25% or more in profit. I'm able to take a percentage of the profit, pay the interest back to the policy, just the interest, so that it doesn't compound or interrupt my cash value performance, right? Because I don't want to take a loan to pay the loan interest from the policy. So I'm going to use either profits or cash flow to always pay the loan interest on a yearly basis so it does not compound. Okay, that's another thing that I've improved with my infinite banking strategy compared to older videos that I've made. And I'm gonna have more videos that kind of goes over infinite banking improvements that I made with the strategy and whatnot. So that is the strategy, okay? You can write that down. Those are the steps. IBC, that's the policy. Borrow against, boom. It's gonna land in your personal checking account or business checking account. Money then funds the network marketing business. Boom. Ideas to produce profit. You're basically self-financing a new business. That's what you're doing. Network marketing is a business, right? You're buying into a business opportunity with the hopes of producing profits and cash flow, all right? So now, the next component, I just want to go over some key information before any of you decide to just join any network marketing company, any MLM, any direct sales. There are some parameters now that I've went through 6 to 7, 8 different companies and comp plans. I developed a template for myself to evaluate the most ideal network marketing company for me. Okay. So some key information first, product of the product. Do you even like the product or is it a money play? For me, Legal Shield, I love the product. I think it's great. It triggered some personal emotions, being that, you know, I've got a story that I can attach to that model, which can benefit many other people that have also experienced that to some capacity. So I'm a product of the product. I spend $2,226 per year on legal services and products within the company. I got many different products. I have the Legal Shield plan. I've got identity theft protection. I've got trial protection. I've got a gun protection. I've got a business plan protection. I also purchase legal and identity theft protection for my immediate family. I've got legal protection, identity theft protection for my girlfriend I pay for my sister. So when you tally all that up in a year, I'm personally spending $2,226 per year, regardless of me being in the business. That's what I pay per year. So when I talk to a prospect, to a client, I can show them, say, listen, my concern here is not making money. This just so happens to be in alignment with some of the missions and core values that I have. And it just so happens that I have the ability to sell this product and make money from it. But even prior to that, I was a client for 4 years before I even joined the business. So I have, you know, customer experience, and I'm also putting, you know, quite a bit of money per year. $2,226 to defend my whole entire kingdom is nominal to me when I'm making high revenues, right? So I'm able to have that conversation. I think that's some key details as an individual. If you're considering joining any network marketing company, I think it's important to be either a product of the product, experience the product before you actually sell it, and, you know, fall into the hype of what you're being sold into, right? So that's key. First is product of the product. That's what I pay. The second thing is startup cost, okay? I wrote 10 grand. That's for me personally. I thought of every single possible expense joining a network marketing company for the first year, what it would cost. My number, my budget is 10,000 per year, right? That's my budget, startup cost. The reality is it costs nowhere near that to actually join the Legal Shield business. There's a $99 startup fee. There's like a $21 monthly charge subscription to get access to having a replicated website, somewhat of a CRM, resources, training, and then whatever you pay per month, per year on the products themselves, right? Then there's business events, seminars, workshops that you can pay for. There's additional training and certifications that you can get to sell the product in other states. Some states require an actual license, a PNC, property and casualty license, to actually provide this service into their state. Okay. Other states, not an issue. So I looked at every single possible cost, including marketing, the cost to market, the gas, if I'm going to be meeting clients in person, lunches, if I'm going to be inviting someone to lunch to present this product. I thought of it all. $10,000 was my startup cost. Okay. I think that's very realistic. You know, the reality is a lot of these network marketing companies, the gurus, the experts, the influencers that are promoting their network marketing company, they're talking about, you know, my $25 business, my $100 business, my $200 business. Yeah, to join, that's just one piece of the puzzle. But just like any business, you've got marketing costs, taxes, cost of operation, inflation, right? You've got training costs, traveling costs, food. I mean, it's like, who are we kidding, right? Who are we kidding? So I like to be very realistic with you guys, right? That's the second key component. The third is to look at the compensation plan. And let me tell you, looking at compensation plans are a freaking headache. It is so hard to comprehend a compensation plan. I don't know if it's because my comprehension and reading skills are poor from high school and middle school, but I've heard from many others that compensation plans are so difficult that even the owner of the compensation plan doesn't even interpret or don't even understand their own compensation plan, okay? There's a guy named Robert Proctor, very small YouTube channel, but he creates YouTube videos for network marketing owners and individuals that want to start their own network marketing company. Very, very, very niche type of a service. But if you watch his content, it is brilliant information that you, the prospect, the client, or the person looking to join a network marketing company, you can get some really, really cool insight on it. It's amazing, amazing. And so one of the main things that I look at, again, now that I've gone through 7-8 different companies, I look at compensation plans that rewards producers, not builders, right? When you look at the network marketing industry, MLM and direct sales, most, if not all of them, reward builders. What does builder mean? Builder is someone that simply recruits people into the company. They're not necessarily selling the product that the company is offering. That's not their play. Their play is to recruit people into the opportunity, right? Recruit. I don't like that model personally, because I am not a recruiter. I am a producer. I sell things, right? I teach, I educate, I tend to throw a little dose of inspiration and motivation, but my intent is for you to obtain resources and information so you can better your life. If it so happens that you want to do what I do and you want to have a level, or you want to copy some of the things that I'm doing, whether it's the marketing, the videos, the YouTube, the Instagram, the Clubhouse, whatever it is, I don't mind sitting down with that person, because I know that they are also a producer, possibly a builder. I don't mind sitting with that one person. But my intent when I get into the network marketing industry is I just love the products. Like, that's, I'm just a glorified customer. Like, I'm a high net worth customer that just loves the products in the network marketing industry. Either A, because they're cheaper, or B, they could be higher in cost, but more value, which ends up being cheaper compared to the other model where I gotta keep buying over and over again. You know, for example, if you look at Caterpillar Machinery, which is used for, you know, construction, farmland, even for our military, Caterpillar tracks, the tracks on those things, they last forever. They're built to last forever. So they're high in value and in cost, but if you compare it to a Komatsu, which is gonna break in the first year or 2 years, you have to maintain it or maintenance it. A farmer, a business owner that's constantly doing construction is gonna spend $300,000, $400,000, $500,000, $1 million on one machine compared to three Komatsus, because they know that Caterpillar is gonna last them forever. Comes with a warranty, customer service, value, okay? So that's how I look at network marketing products sometimes. It's like the value is just crazy high. And that's another parameter that I have in regards to when I'm looking at being a product of the product is how good is the product and how likely am I to keep recurring as a customer. So I'm going to keep paying $2,226 for the next 40, 50, as long as I live, because that's protecting my kingdom. I have no problem doing that. Regardless of whoever I sell the product to, I'm going to keep doing me, right? It just so happens that I have the ability to sell it. Why not? Covers my cost, right? And then I'm able to produce, like I said, profits. So the third component was the compensation plan that rewards producers, meaning that the commissions, when I sell the product, the question you want to ask yourself, or when you're speaking to the person that's trying to recruit you in their business, in the network marketing business, you ask them this one question, and if they can't answer it, or if they don't know and they're going to get the answer, or if it's a no, then you might want to run from it. Because the reality is that most people are not good at recruiting. Most people are not very good recruiters. I'm not a good recruiter. I'm a good sales guy, I believe, based on my track record so far. I believe I'm a decent salesperson, you know? I believe it's easier to sell products than it is to recruit, because you got to sell a vision, right? You got to sell a mission, intangible, can't see it. Whereas a product, booms, right there. You like it, you don't like it, have a nice day. You like it, great, bye. It becomes a law of numbers, right? 1 out of 10 buys, 2 out of 10 buys, your closing rate is anywhere from 10 to 20%. Simple. When you recruit, whole nother mindset. You got to think big, long-term. You got to sell the vision, the mission of someone else's vision and mission, not necessarily yours, excuse me. So you ask the question, does this company reward producers? And can I become, let's phrase it this way, when you're sitting down with the person that's going to recruit you into their network marketing business, you say, Mr. Joe, can I become successful financially just selling the product? No recruiting. It's a yes or no question. Straightforward. It's a yes or no question. Most of the time, many companies, compensation plans I looked at, leaning on the no side. Why? Because network marketing companies are designed typically to build people, recruit people, right? Typically. Very few network marketing companies have the option where you can be a builder, a recruiter, or just a producer. Where you're like, dude, I don't care about recruiting. I don't want to recruit people. I'm not into that. That's not me. And let's say you're a really good sales guy or a saleswoman. You're like, you just love the product and you want to tell the world about it. Great. Can he or she be successful financially just selling the product? If you get a yes, that means that particular network marketing company gives you the option of two. You can be a producer or a recruiter, or you can be both. So really three options, right? Those companies are very, very unique and hard to come by. And I believe, based on my research, I found two so far. I think there's some others out there, but I found two so far. So a compensation plan that rewards producers is a nice indicator. It makes me feel safe because I don't have to recruit if I don't want to make a lot of money. I don't have to recruit. I can just sell personal volume. That means I'm not reliant on other people to do the work for me. It's about my performance. So that means my paycheck is directly correlated to the amount that I perform. And when I look at the commissions on every product that gets sold, I look at that and I times it by 100 customers, 150 customers, 500 customers, however many customers it takes to make multiple or break past six figures, right? So the way I answer the question, in my mind, the follow-up, if they say yes, you can become successful just producing by selling the product, my follow-up question is, how many customers do I have to sell to make six figures, right? How many customers do I have to sell to make six figures, right? So when I look at that, I'm like, all right, let's say you're selling a high-end product and the commission out the gate when you start off is maybe $300 and then it caps out at maybe $600, right? So you could take 100 grand and divide it by $300, you would need to acquire 333 clients. To me, that's not bad at all. In the last 3 years, I've accumulated over 1,000 clients in my business, and that resulted in over $1 million in revenue. It's not bad at all, right? So that means the average, you know, if we just went off 1,000, I know it's a little, let me do 1,100. So if I made $1 million in the last 3 years and I accumulated 1,100 clients, my average lifetime value, ALV, my average lifetime value of each and every client that comes through my door is $909. This is my business, right? Okay, great. When I look at a network marketing company, success to me is breaching over 100K because that's 2X the average income in America. So as long as I 2X it and then anything above that, then you hit market dominance and then it takes off from there. But if it takes me, say, 1,500 customers, over 1,000 customers just to make 100 grand, that's very hard to do, right? Think about it. $100,000 divided by 1,000 clients, that's only $100 per client. I think you're better off, you know, go get a 4-year degree education at college and work for a tech company, Google, and make over 6 figures. You know, be a doctor, be a lawyer, be a CPA, an accountant, a financial consultant, and make over 100,000, 200,000, and maybe have half that, 500 or less clients. So this is another way. You're taking notes, you're asking the question, when you sit down with that individual, you say, okay, can I become successful financially just selling the product? They say yes. Your follow-up question is, how many customers does it take to make 6 figures? Through that, they say 1,000, 900. Then all you have to do is take 100 grand divided by the amount of customers required, and then you see. The follow-up you do in your math, you say, okay, how much time, effort required does it take to acquire customer acquisition, to acquire the customer? What's the cost to acquire the customer and how much time? If you end up with a scenario where your customer acquisition cost is like 30% of $100 and then it takes you 3 hours to acquire the customer, well, then you do, say the example of $100 is the result to make 6 figures, 1,000 clients, $100 per client. Your customer acquisition costs, say it's $20, so minus 80, and then it takes you 3 hours to acquire the client, $80 divided by 3, you're making $26 an hour. Now, if you're a career type of a guy, white collar, blue collar, and you drive trucks for a living, you make $35 an hour driving trucks, aren't you better off continuing to drive trucks than to look at this type of a model? That's something to think on. Or you might say, I'm willing to do that because it aligns with my mission and value. Then okay, cool. But I like to look at it from a numbers perspective. Is this profitable according to how I'm currently making money? Does it breach? So let's say it was, you know, in order to make a 100 grand, you had to do 350 customers. So that means your average lifetime value of that customer is $285 per customer, and your acquisition cost was $35. So minus $35, you're at 250, and it takes you 4 hours to acquire one customer. You're making $62 an hour. Not bad. Not bad. Now, what's the likelihood of you obtaining 350 customers in the first year? Very unlikely, right? Let's just be real. Very unlikely. Now, can it be done? Absolutely. The likelihood, very low. So let's go with the statistics, the stats. How long, this is now personal, you and me, how long am I willing to play that game to acquire 350 customers to make 6 figures and then continue to make 6 figures moving forward? I like to look at it from a 5 to 10 year, I'm not even gonna say 5 year, I say 7 to 10 year time frame when looking at network marketing to produce multiple 6 figures. 7 to 10 years minimal to produce multiple 6 figures. You might accumulate 6 figures in the first 5 years, but you made 20 grand, 30 grand, 10, 25, that's different. I'm talking your first 100 grand in 1 year might take you 7 to 10 years if you're someone with no sales experience, no marketing experience, no business experience. like you're lacking that. I like to be very, very realistic, you know? And I look at my own numbers and I evaluate myself. And like I said earlier, this is a 20 to 40 year play. Coming back to the key info, right? Product of the product. I look at the startup costs. Comp plan, does it reward producers? Yes. How quickly can I make six figures according to customer amount? And the range that I like, the lower the number, the better, right? So if it's like, if it starts to start breaching like 500, 600 clients or more just to make six figures, that's like an insane amount of work. But if it's like 300, 200, 150, that to me is like not bad at all. That's very, very attractive. So, and then the last thing is, you know, great products, value to the client, alignment with your purpose and values. Legal Shield's alignment with my value to receive justice in America. If I'm ever in the situation, have protection. If I'm ever sued, if I'm liable for anything, I got a lawyer, I got attorneys, I can reach out to you, I can get my will done, estate planning, trust. I mean, the whole nine. I have access to an entire law firm in my local area here in South Florida. I can drive up to them, I can talk to them. They have them, the law firm hosts meetings and educational meetings for their Legal Shield clients. It's wonderful, okay? So key components, the system, four major numbers, the tool, companies, case study, Legal Shield, 20 to 40 year play. In 2019, when I joined the business, I made $129.89, startup cost, 10 grand. I didn't necessarily spend 10 grand in 2019, but that was my budget. I'm already spending $2,226 per year. So I'm already at a loss. Does that make sense? Why am I doing that? 20 to 40 year play. Eventually I profit. Second year, made $1,726.42. That is over a 10x increase. Would you agree? Absolutely. All right. That's 2020, 2021. Currently, it's October 2021. I've made $1,251.56 to date. And my projection model here is to increase revenue by 25% each year. So the goal by the end of this year is to get to $2,158.02. And this is just producing, production sales. If someone joins under me in the network marketing model in the business, great, I'll work with that person. But my intent is just to sell and educate a great product. I'm not even concerned about the business model of network marketing, recruiting, bonuses, vacations, and free BMW, free Mercedes, and free trip to Maui, and da da da. I don't care, none of that. That is all features and benefits that's here and there, that none of that's guaranteed. The only thing that is guaranteed in my eyes in a compensation plan is whatever the commission rate is on when I sell the product, not when I recruit. There's no guarantee that you're gonna recruit people, but there is a guarantee that when you sell a product, you're gonna get paid, right? That in the very beginning. When you recruit someone in the business, you may not necessarily make money because they need to do work in order for you to get paid, right? There may be a bonus or something, but that's here or there, and that can change. That's subject to change. And you'll see that description under every compensation plan with every network marketing company. They'll say compensation plans are subject to change at any point without any notice of approval from you or anyone in the business. So that's why I don't even look at none of that stuff. Vacations, trip to Maui, blah, 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 free BMW, free Chrysler. That's hype to me. None of that is guaranteed. Just show me how much money can I make commission-wise, percentage-wise, when I sell this product. That's all I care about. So 3 year, should end the year 2,158.02. And then let's just go year by year. How long does it take to become a millionaire, right? So just growing at 25%, there's gonna be years where I jump by 50 or do 10, you know? But the average growing by 25% is what I laid out for myself. Year four, 2,697.52. Year five, 3,371. Year six, revenue, 4,214. Year seven, 5,268, 6,500, 8,000. And in my notes here, the year that I would have made my first six figures would be by year 20. No, it would be by year 2038, right? So let's do the math. 2038 minus 2019 is when I joined a bit. Yeah. So by year 19, I would have made just under 100K. By 2038, right? Would have made that much money, six figures. And then by year 31, I'm generating 1.1 5 million, right? $1,115,662.59 in revenue. This is a long-term play. This business, Legal Shield, they've been in business for 50 years. I don't think they're going anywhere, right? So they've already proven their proof of concept. Been in business for 50 years. They got a great product. Just like any business, they've got pros and cons. They've got their fair share of bad reviews, their fair share of fines and bad experiences. And just to provide even more transparency, there's a couple of YouTube channels that you can check out. One is called like Illuminati, but spelt weird. And it's got over a million subscribers. And that person, it's a woman, she did a review on the Legal Shield company. It's a negative review, right? So you can check that out. You can look at the good, the bad, and the ugly. For the most part, I've been sharing like the good, but in a very transparent way, like realistically, you know, the reality is with network marketing, like 95% or more fail in network marketing. Why? Because they quit the first year, the second year, the third year, the fourth year, the fifth year. I told you, 7 to 10 year projection is what you should have in mind to actually stay in that business and not jump from comp plan to the next comp plan to the next comp plan and fall into that hype, you know? And it's very hard to not fall into the hype, you know? Free Chrysler, pay your BMW payment, we pay your house off, we, you know, trips all year round. Nobody talks about work. Hey, you gotta work to get that. Right, no one's really talking. All you gotta do is recruit two who bring two, and they bring two, and that, and it's a two. You look like a two. You know, like what's going on? So the reality is that 95% fail. Most people don't make more than $1,000-$5,000 per year in the company. And typically, when you hear the success stories of the people in network marketing at the highest level, most of them are recruiters. They're all recruiters. Very few are straight up producers with a little bit of recruiting, where they focus more on producing the product, selling the product, than recruiting the opportunity, the dream, the illusion, okay? So the way that I've been talking, it's a love-hate relationship in regards to network marketing. I love network marketing because of the business model and the opportunities that are there. And then sometimes I really hate it. You know, hate's a strong word, but I really dislike some of the practices, because that industry could improve so much, just like the life insurance industry. There are so many ways that we can improve as insurance agents and network marketers that we're just not tapping into the opportunity. And therefore, we look like a bunch of schmucks, right? That are just selling, we get that commission breath. It's horrible. I don't like it. And I call people out, you know, in the network marketing. I'm like, dude, what are you telling me? What are you telling me? I've got a very functional, lively business here, and you're trying to tell me that network marketing is the only way to go. Dude, I'm having success right here. Why would I join you for $20 to earn $2 commission on a product? Like, come on. Like, just be open, honest, and transparent with me. Give me all the facts. Give me the good, the bad, the ugly, and I'll make a decision. So that's my goal. Like I said, while I'm presenting this, I want to give you the good, I want to give you the bad, I want to give you the ugly. So the ugly on Legal Shield, you go, you look up, you can look up Legal Shield is a scam, right? You can look that up. That'll probably populate some very negative review videos. You can type in Legal Shield reviews. Those can be a little more transparent. And there's one YouTube channel called Illuminati. I don't even know how to spell it, but you'll know you're at the right place because the logo is like a pyramid with an eye. And then they've got 1 million or more subscribers, and they have one video on Legal Shield. Pretty transparent, you know, very, very, like, I want to say for the most part, there was like, I think a lot of facts in there, maybe not all facts. And then mostly, you know, you're listening from a very biased anti-MLM type of a person, where they believe all network marketing companies are bad. But again, it's good to hear from that side and then hear from the pro network marketing people and then kind of like in between. So me, I'm in between. There's a degree where I really dislike network marketing. There's legitimate illegal pyramid schemes out there for sure. And they're constantly being caught and shut down by the SEC and other regulators. Then there's a side of me that's very pro because of the numbers, for the most part. The numbers, and then the product is very good. Like there's some great products out there. You know, there's a company called Melaleuca. I've been buying products from Melaleuca, never joined the company. I'm just a customer. I've been buying Melaleuca products since, I wanna say, like since 2016, 2017, multiple years. And I buy it on a monthly basis. I get my shampoo, my toothpaste, my deodorant, my floss, mouthwash, dish detergent, laundry detergent, cleaning products. I mean, it's all for the home. Very biodegradable stuff and very, very clean products. Doesn't leave bad smells in your house, like those heavy smells like Lysol and those heavy, heavy smells when you're using bleach or any type of other very strong products. These aren't harmful to your lungs. So, but I never joined the business. Great freaking product. Effective pricing. I've saved a ton of money. They've got a credit card where you get 6% cash back rewards shopping through their site. So I get the credit card, 6% cash back. I'm buying products at effective pricing that will last me just as long as the name brand products at Walmart in the stores, right? And then in addition to that, they've got a little section where you watch videos to learn about their products and they give you money, like a credit to shop at their store. Like you'll get $15 for watching a 10-minute video or $5, $10, $8, $12. And that never stops, by the way. You keep getting more and more money. So I've saved thousands of dollars over the last few years just by shopping there. I've never joined the business, you know? So I think there's legitimate models out there. And so what I want to get into now is the like commission breakdown. Give you an example of what it looks like, what would be reasonable, right? So with Legal Shield, there's two products that are very popular. There's the Legal Shield plan, and then there's the Identity Theft Protection plan. The Legal Shield plan costs $29.95 currently. The Identity Theft Protection plan costs $34.95, and this covers your whole family, I believe, and the three bureaus, Equifax, TransUnion, Experian, right? Covers all three bureaus and your entire immediate family, like your husband, wife, and then kids, right? So multiple people, $34.95. If someone was to buy these two products, that's like 60 something a month, times that by 12, they're gonna spend $778.80 a year. The commission that I would likely receive on that, a little under 28%, or a little over, I think, would be $220 is the commission according to the current 2021 compensation plan of this company, Legal Shield. Now, when it comes to network marketing, there are ranks. There's ranks. And you initially start off at like the very first rank, whatever that, usually it's like new associate, new agent, independent agent. They got a name for it. Then as you sell product, you increase in rank little by little. So when you're looking at the compensation plan, in order to really determine whether or not it rewards producers is by looking at how far can you go in rank before you're cut off and you have to recruit in order to get to the higher ranks. Every single network marketing company, including Legal Shield, including United Financial Freedom, I may be incorrect, but again, compensation plans are very, very hard to interpret. But with Legal Shield and United Financial Freedom and every other network marketing company I've looked at, there is a cutoff in terms of how high you can go in rank just based off your personal performance, your personal production in sales. I think with Legal Shield, that rank is called director. And this is roughly five ranks from the beginning rank of associate. So at the director level, you get 220. At the associate level, I think it's like maybe half that number. All right, I have to look at it. I forget. But essentially, to rank to director is not hard in terms of personal production in sales. Not hard at all. In the last 2-3 years, I think I've accumulated in the neighborhood of 30 to 40 customers, and I am currently at a senior manager, which is one rank below director, okay? And then once you get to director, the rank above that is executive director, or ED for short. And if I'm not mistaken, in order to hit that rank, no matter how much you produce in personal volume, you have to have some kind of a recruiting people under you, and they also producing, which that's where, you know, I don't like that. Because if I'm just selling, like if I bring in 100 new customers a year, 200 new customers a year, 300 new customers a year, and you're telling me I can't rank up from there, yet I'm producing probably better than every one of your other ranking people just from my own personal production, that kind of sucks, because I'm capped at how much I can make. I have to recruit. So when I look at that, kind of sucks. But then I say, well, just being at director, can I become successful? The answer is yes, with this model, because I'll get paid 28% roughly on two of the most popular products, which is an easy sell. I get 220 advance per customer, right? So just looking at 220, $100,000 divided by 220, I need 454 customers, right? That's breaching over 500. That's where it gets a little rough for me. When it's like 500 and up, I'm like, ugh, gets a little tough. But again, this is a very low tier product, right? Imagine if it was a $500 product and it cost, and your commission was 220 on a $500 product. And it was 220, or if it was like, no, I'm a liar, because this is technically over $500. Let's say it was a like a $1,500 product, $1,200 product, and you're getting paid, you know, 200 or 300, it's gonna take you more customers to get there. So it's a low tier product initially, because the client only needs to pay $29.95, and then you get an advance of $220. And as long as you retain that customer, which is really nice and ideal, then there is what's called residual income, where in this, by the 13th month, if that client retained their membership for the full year and then continued their membership in the 13th month, you get a 10% advance of the 220. So that's $22, right? Let's say the average lifetime value of a customer like this is 10 years. And I'm gonna be receiving overrides for the next 10 to 20 years on that customer for as long as they retain their membership. And if I get $22 in the first year, and I don't know what it's like in the following years, but let's say it, the number drops by 50%, so it's like 10 bucks. So then 10 times the next 18 years, you get $180 plus the 22 plus the 220. Lifetime value of the client is 422. Now I know that number is not correct. I know it's higher. So the average lifetime value of that one customer will pay, you know, say $600 or more. Now, the other thing to understand is, even if you don't recruit people, like that's not your model, what's going to happen is you're going to have some kind of turnover where someone, one of your customers, like, hey, how do I sell this? Can I be an affiliate? Can I like refer people? Sure. Boom. Here you go. Bomb. Here's what it costs to sell the product. And you go from there. And you'll rank up. So the higher you go in rank, the higher the commission is, right? But like I said, with Legal Shield, I believe there's a cutoff when it comes to commissions and ranks, where you have to recruit to get to the higher ranks. You can't just go off personal volume. Now, the reason why I actually stayed with the company, even after learning this, is they do have a component strictly for producers, which is something called B2B, solutions. Now, this right here is all based off performance. You don't have to recruit to make a ton of money in this department. And this is what I really like about the company. This right here is like their main bread and butter, from what I've seen. I mean, this is a big component of their business as well, but they tend to promote this to the average Joe, everyday working American. B2B solutions is really awesome because I can go to a company of say 100 employees, right? And I can sell them the same product at a discount, a group rate, a couple dollars cheaper than $29.95, let's say the Legal Shield plan or the Identity Theft Protection plan. And I individually will get paid, you know, probably more than 28%. I guess this does depend on rank and all, but I don't have to recruit a soul to make a ton of money in B2B solutions. So imagine you get five companies, five corporations with 100 employees. That's 500 customers, and they're all paying, say this, and then you get paid that, say 220 times 500 people. That's over six figures, right? And that's just at this rate. Again, I know for a fact that commission's actually a little higher on this side because the product is a little bit more expensive. Or because it's a group rate, they could be paying, they're able to pay a higher commission because they're getting a group of 100 or 50 people to enroll. And so that's really, really cool. It's a nice component. Again, this company is rewarding producers, not just recruiters. So they have a recruiting model, a production model, and then a recruiting plus production model where you can say, okay, after, let's say you do this for a few years, and maybe you might want to hire someone to go out there for you. You know, if I've been doing this for 20 to 40 years, right? And I'm in my late 50s and late 60s, I may not want to produce anymore. And that's where the recruiting model becomes very effective because you can bring in the next young gun to go out there and acquire companies or simply manage the customers you already have. And so you can build a model like that just to retain the business. Again, you get paid on the sale of the product, and then there's a 10 to 20 year residual override. $22, maybe $10, $15, but times that by hundreds and hundreds of customers over a 20 to 40 year timeline, you know, I don't see why anyone could produce, you know, over 1,000 customers. And like I said, make multiple six figures, even multiple seven figures in the later years. Realistically, by year 31, you're producing over seven figures, right? But by year 18, 19, you're making multiple six figures, right? That's an activity, not counting residuals. You know, there's going to be residuals added on to that to increase the number even more. Then there's the recruiting. So there's a lot of different options, right? The other thing with when you're looking at the comp plan, what I preferably like is the non-guarantees, right? Which is those, what I mentioned earlier, the trips, the, you know, pay your car payment and the bonuses, the incentives. So those are additional things that can dramatically increase your income. But again, I'm just going off of what I can make off of the sale of the product, minus the bonus, minus the incentives, minus the trips, minus the buy my car and take care of my payment, minus all of that, which is all great stuff. But again, it's not guaranteed because they can switch it up whenever they want. But what tends to be very, very consistent and stable is how they pay commissions on the product that they're selling. So when I look at it, just off the 220, right? How many customers do we need? 454 customers to make over six figures, right? And then you take those 454, times it by $22, that's an extra 10 grand in residual income off those 454 residual income for the next 10 to 20 years. And so you can essentially build up a very, very strong override commission over a 10 to 15, 20, 25 year period where the residual income alone is producing six figures. And then you have your activity, new customers coming in. And then you have the second play, which is B2B. This is B2C, right? You're going to customers. This is B2B, business to business solutions, where you're providing employee benefit plans of legal protection, identity theft protection, trial court protection, gun protection, a lot of other products and services, then the company, the corporation themselves, can purchase a plan for them, which is called Business Solutions, where they've got small business plans, essential plan, pro plan, and those are much higher ticket subscription models. And again, that commission can be, you know, very, very good long term. So when I am looking at the infinite banking concept and network marketing, I'm looking at my ability to produce instead of me throwing money into investments outside of myself, which, again, to be fully transparent, I am doing that. With my infinite banking policies, I borrow against the cash value. I'm buying cryptocurrencies. I've got an HSA. I've got a Roth. I've got a brokerage account. I've done real estate transaction once before. I will be doing real estate transactions. I feed money back into my business. That's six things. I run expenses through the policy to recapture cash flow costs. That's seven things. And now eight, network marketing. So eight different ways that I'm producing additional income, revenue, profits with the same dollars. And remember, ladies and gentlemen, this 70 grand, this 15 grand are savings dollars. So if you look at the cash flow alone, 10,000 times 12 is 120K, 15,000 times 12 is 180K. My realistic cash flow per year is around 180,000 a year is what I will cash flow if I make 300 grand a year. Over the last 3 years in business, I've averaged about 300K in revenue, a little over 300 grand, more like 330. So when you take my cash flow number, right, 180,000 minus 70 and 15, so minus 85 grand, I still have $95,000. That money is getting invested. Take care of taxes, costs, operating costs, inflation, reinvesting in the business, learning new things, getting coaching, mentorship, and yada, 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 all that. The 85,000 is protection from the investment. So you have to understand how to separate your investing dollars from your savings dollars. Very important. You don't want to commingle unless you've got a strategy like this and you're willing to put some of those dollars to work because you're able to split the dollar into two, right? It's very dangerous to compare investment dollars with savings dollars. Why? Because those are two separate environments. Savings is all about protecting your wealth, growing at a compounded rate, investing in safe liquid assets, investing in things that are safe, have guarantees, consistent, right? The money's gonna be there, you're not gonna lose it. You don't wanna compare that rate of return to your investments because your investments are always gonna outperform your savings. That's the purpose of an investment, is to take on risk for high reward. When I'm taking my savings dollars, $85,000 a year in savings gets planted and parked in cash value life insurance. Great. That's going to grow at a tax-free, compounded, uninterrupted interest rate. Wonderful. I then take a percentage of that money. Look, 10,000, right? What is 10,000 out of 85K? Very small percentage, right? The reality is I'm not even taking out that much. That was just startup costs. Now, to be honest with you, very transparent, I did not initially do IBC and network marketing back in 2019 when I joined the company. I'm gonna be doing it, I'm gonna be rolling it out in 2021 where I put my savings dollars in here and then I'm gonna borrow out a couple $1,000, one to cover my products per year that I purchase and then my marketing costs to run the business and the website and all that internal costs of just running that network marketing business. I'm gonna fund it through my policy starting in 2022. That's when this will kind of officially roll out. So I've been working it out of my head now and seeing what fruit that will produce later. What's nice about that is that the investment dollars, that other $95,000, now just increased to say over 100 grand. Because again, I'm using savings dollars that I wasn't gonna touch anyways. and I only take out a percentage of what I have in cash value. My percentage number is 66%. That's the most amount of money I will borrow from my policy, is 66%. So if we look at the total cash value to date, $201,580.64 plus $33,267, we're at $234, times that by 66%, I should have $154,000 in loans, but I don't, right? I've got $79,446.83 plus $13,500. I only got $92,000 in loans. So I've got about $50,000 of space, and that's where my mind is saying, what can I do with that additional space? And then I always will have 30 to 40% of my savings that covers emergency. That number alone covers my expenses for over 1 year. That's not bad. That's the ideal model. Okay. My lesson is complete. We are done.